Good day to you. This is your midday news from Vox Africa Studios here in London. I am Pamela Bonkyung. Our major stories today begin in the Central African Republic. The government delegation postponed its trip to Gabon yesterday for the peace talks. This came after the Seleka rebel alliance captured the towns of Alindao and Damara, further jeopardizing peace talks starting today. The delegates are said to be leaving today for Gabon's capital Libreville to kickstart other peace talks. The rebel delegation arrived this morning in Gabon for the peace talks. The insurgents are demanding an end to years of exclusion from government. Bozize, who seized power in a 2003 coup before winning a 2005 election, opened a so-called inclusive political dialogue with his rebel force in 2008. Let's hear from the head of the government delegation on what they aim to achieve in Gabon.
We are going with the democratic spirit. Wherever government, wherever democratic opposition, wherever rebel, we fought to build our country, a constitution that everybody today respect. And therefore, this is what we will discuss. And I believe that we are one another good democrat, which is why I see why the government's arguments stay the course.
Now, the president of the Central African Republic on Monday traveled to Congo Brazzaville. He was welcomed at the airport by the country's president, Denis Sassou Nguesso. Sassou Nguesso is going to act as mediator in the peace talks in Gabon between the Central African Republic government and the rebels. Congo Brazzaville has also sent troops to its neighbor to back up government soldiers against possible rebel assault. The youth in the Central African Republic are becoming increasingly restless with the situation in their country. Some have been accused by the government for joining the rebels to cause confusion and disturb the peace. But for most of the youth gathered at this stadium, they're ready to take up arms and defend their country against the instability the rebels have brought into it. Though the rebels hold that the government did not honour its 2008 comprehensive peace agreement with them, others in the country believe this government runs deep and stems from a very different source.
There is no representative institution in our country. Assembly is only full of people from the government parties. There are 104 parliamentarians and 99 are linked to the government. And you have his wife, his brothers, his son, cousin, and so only his family can create a parliamentary group. Rebels are
said to have moved. Christine Lagarde, the head of the International Monetary Fund, is on an African tour at the moment. She arrived in Ivory Coast on Monday and laid a wreath in Abidjan for the victims of the stampede on New Year's Eve, which left 63 people dead and over 250 injured. Lagarde remarked that Africa's emerging nations could become a driving force for world economic growth. However, she expressed concern regarding armed conflicts, which poses a big threat to the continent's development. According to the IMF, economic growth in Africa is projected at 5.2% in 2013. This rate places the region second only to Asia's booming economy. We move over to North Africa. Libya's Prime Minister Ali Zaiden met with Tunisian counterpart Hamadi Djabali on Monday to discuss relations between the two neighbours. The two countries, according to Libyan PM Zaiden, are committed to improving security in their border region. With regards to security, Zaiden called on the militia within his country not to take the laws into their hands. Tunisia was the first Arab country to undergo the Arab Spring. Last June, it extradited former Libyan leaders Muammar Gaddafi's deposed prime minister to stand trial in his country, Libya. Now it's in Europe, just when the protest and violence seems to be calming down. In North Ireland's Belfast, violence escalated on Monday night. It is estimated that around 1,000 pro-British protesters picketed Belfast City Hall and engaged in violence fights with the police. And Northern Ireland's police chief has appealed to all political organisers and parents of youth involved in violence to help rein it in. The protest was triggered by the decision of Belfast City Council, dominated by pro-Irish members, to stop flying the British flag every day of the year. Australia's bushfires have continued and are spreading fast through the southeastern states. Fires continued to burn this morning near the New South Wales town of Gunning. Over 80 firefighters have been trying to bring down the flames under the country. Australia's Prime Minister yesterday visited the town of Denali in Tasmania to offer support to victims whose homes had been burnt by the fires. Australia's Bureau of Meteorology has issued a warning today, predicting that today will bring with it the highest and most catastrophic bushfire temperature. People have been advised to flee if fire threatens. In the United States, President Barack Obama has nominated Chuck Hagel as Defense Secretary and John Brennan for the position of CIA Director. Let's get their reactions to their nominations.
To help meet the challenges of our time, I'm proud to announce my choice for two key members of my national security team. Chuck Hagel for Secretary of Defense and John Brennan for Director of the Central Intelligence Agency. I hope that the Senate will act on these confirmations promptly. When it comes to national security, we don't like to leave a lot of gaps between the time that one set of leaders transitions out and another transitions in. So we need to get moving quickly on this.
I'm also grateful for an opportunity to help continue to strengthen our country and strengthen our country's alliances and advance global freedom, decency, and humanity as we help build a better world for all mankind. I will always do my best. I will do my best for our country, for those I represent at the Pentagon, and for all our citizens. And Mr. President, I will always give you my honest and most informed counsel.
If confirmed as director, I will make it my mission to ensure that the CIA has the tools it needs to keep our nation safe and that its work always reflects the liberties, the freedoms, and the values that we hold so dear.
We move over to Latin America as tensions continue to rise in Venezuela. As Inauguration Day nears, the president of the National Assembly has called on the country to rally in support for their leader, Chavez, as he recovers from his cancer surgery in Cuba. Chavez was supposed to be sworn in on the 10th of this month, but his ill health means he cannot attend. This has led to unrest and fear of a power vacuum. In the meantime, Venezuela's Catholic Church has criticized the government, saying it is morally unacceptable to alter the constitution in order to achieve political goals. The head of the Venezuelan Conference of Bishops, Diego Padron, said it was not the purpose of the assembly to intervene publicly in the interpretation of the constitution. A Kenyan runner during a race in Brazil was tackled by a member of the public. Edwin Kipsang Rotich was competing in the King's Race in the Brazilian city of Cuiabá on Sunday when this happened. Rotich, who won the São Silvestre race in Sao Paulo just over a week ago, was not perturbed by the situation and went on to still win first place in the race. Brazilian police said the man who tackled him is known to be mentally unstable. We got to find out last evening who the winners of the FIFA's prestigious Ballon d'Or were. Argentina's Lionel Messi won his fourth Ballon d'Or. Graciously, he was named the world's best player after scoring a remarkable 91 goals in 2012. Quite a record. The United States' Abby Wambach received the Women's Player of the Year award. The reactions were varied. They ranged from humble to excitement and, most of all, gratitude.
I feel overwhelmed, happy, excited, surprised, humbled. Honestly, this is one of the most amazing experiences for me because it's really an honor of all my teammates, both present and past. There's no way I'm here if it's not for Alex Morgan, if it's not for Marta. I mean, Marta, I've always played against her, but she's challenged me. She's challenged my team and has made me better because of the ways that she's challenged our team and when we played her.
The South Korean rap sensation Psy, better known for his hits on Gangnam Style, was the subject of an ice sculpture in China's Harbin Ice Festival. China's 29th annual ice and snow festival in the northeastern city of Harbin is known for its enormous ice sculptures. A 20-foot ice statue of Gangnam Style welcomed guests to the city's show. It seemed to attract more visitors than usual. Here is Ahmed Reta Anwar, the sculptor behind Sai's eye sculpture.
Our sculpture is like an exhibit for many tourists in all over the globe. When they come to China, they see our sculpture, so they were like, no, oh, Malaysian is warm in hospitality and friendship. So that's how our sculpture resembles the whole entire team.
Well, thank you for watching. We shall see you in a moment.